Now we will discuss about the biomechanical properties of the tendons and ligaments. So they're basically the viscoelastic in nature. What it means is that whenever a material is viscoelastic, it means that they will deform and return to its original shape in a non-linear manner. Now, if we look at the word viscoelasticity, it consists of two words, viscous and elasticity. Elasticity is the ability of the material to return to its original dimension after loading. It means that it is returning to its original shape, but at the same time, it also has this viscosity in a property, which is the in which a small amount of load results in quite a bit of the deformation. And this property is present in some fluids which exhibit a friction as layers slide over each other. The basic difference is that in elasticity, energy is stored, but in case of the viscosity, energy is absorbed. So the in this way, tendons and ligaments act as viscoelastic in nature because they will not return to its original shape with complete energy stored. Instead, they will lose some amount of the energy and whenever they return to its original shape, they do that in some non-linear manner. So the difference between the tendons and ligaments, again, that they are strong enough to sustain the high tensile forces, they are sufficiently flexible to angulate around the bone surfaces, and they are like deflect bene retinacula to change the final direction of the muscle pull, and the ligaments are soft and flexible, allow the natural movements of the bones, and they are strong and inextensible to offer sustained resistance to applied force. So here we will discuss about the biomechanical properties of the tendons and ligaments in the form of a graph, which is the load elongation graph. Here we will discuss the biomechanical properties with the constant rate of elongation. Here I would like to mention one thing is that the damage of tendon and ligament depends on two things. First is the rate, and the second is the amount of the load. If we talk about the amount of the load, how much load is applied? It depends on upon the how much load is applied. If the load is applied more than a specific limit, the tendon or the ligament will rupture. But if we on the other hand, if we talk about the rate, then sometimes rate is small but sudden. For example, in case of the athletes and footballers, they twist their ankles in suddenly, and in this case, the rate is small, but it caused the damage. So the damage depends both upon the amount of the load and the rate. Here we will discuss this graph while keeping the rate constant, rate of elongation constant. So here, if we see, and that long elongation curve has several regions that characterize the behavior of the tissue. First region here we'll see is this is the toe region, and the elongation reflected in this region is believed to be the result of a change in the wavy pattern. There you see we have this wavy pattern of the collagen fibers. In this region, the tissue stretches easily without much force. And because when we apply force in this region, these collagen fibers get straightened up here, they were wavy and now they are getting straightened up in this toe region here. So the collagen fibers become straight and lose their wavy pattern while the sliding occurs between the fibrils. So now as this elongation continues, the stiffness of tissue increases and there is a change in the tissue elongation. And this is the, here we have this second region, which is the elastico-linear region. It follows the toe region, the toe region is ending and it is following the toe region linearly. And it is observed as a sudden increase in the slope of the curve, because here you see that the curve is getting linear, and when this linear region is surpassed or passed here at this point, and the major failure of the fiber bundle occurs here at this point, like point 3. And then with the attainment of the maximum load that reflects the ultimate tensile strength, complete failure occur here in this region, region four. So we have four regions: primary region, which is the toe region. Then we have the linear region, which follows after the toe region, and the end of the secondary region here. When this linear region ends, we have the progressive failure. And there we have this fourth region, which is the maximum load point, or you can say this is a failure point that happens. Here you see that failure happened, the tendon or the ligament that was on which the stress was applied has undergone rupture. But at the end of the linear here, you will see this. At the end of the linear, there the ultimate tensile strength, this is the point of the ultimate tensile strength, that maximum load that the tendon and the ligament can bear. Here we will discuss about the long elongation curve of the ligamentum flavum. As I have already discussed and explained before, that the ligamentum flavum have the high amounts of elastin, and that is the reason that their biomechanical properties also differ, because more elastin protein gives more elasticity to the ligament. So we have already discussed about what their functions is, that they are present in the lamina of the vertebrae, and they provide the protection to the spinal nerve roots. So the graph that we discussed here is for the tendons and extremity ligaments. In case of the ligamentum flavum, we have a different graph here. In tensile testing of a human ligamentum flavum, and the elongation of the specimen reached 50% here before the stiffness increased appreciably. Here you see the stiffness is increasing appreciably, and beyond this point the stiffness increased greatly. There you go, it is increasing greatly. And with the additional loading, and ligament failed abruptly with a little deformation here at this point, when it is reached the limit, and the ligament will break after this point. Okay, so here we had this ligamentum flavum, and now we'll discuss about the hysteresis. Hysteresis is the repetition of the loading and unloading. Here you see the two nonlinear curves. Here we have this loading curve, and then we unload. There we go, we have this another curve. Now, one thing that I would like to mention here is that the area under the graph is the amount absorbed. So same way here, we have this area between the two curves, which is the which is called the area of hysteresis, and represents the energy loss between the two tissues. Because energy is, while we load the tendon or ligament, energy is spent, but not all of the energy is recovered back, because when we unload the ligament or tendon, some of the energy is lost. So this repetition of the loading and unloading, which cause the energy to lose, is called a hysteresis. So here we will discuss about the nonlinear behavior of the ligaments and the tendons. And there are two ways to observe this behavior, which is the load and load or stress relaxation, or the creep deformation test. These are the two types of tests that we will perform. The basic difference between both of them is that in creep, deformation occurs under the constant load. You need to remember these two points, that in creep, deformation occurs under the constant load. But in case of the load relaxation, it happens under the constant deformation. So this is the basic difference between the two of them, that creep happens under the constant load, and the load relaxation happens under the constant deformation. We will test these two just now. So before moving ahead, I would like to discuss here that the influence of loading rates on the bone ligament bone complex differs at both the slow and the fast loading. At slow loading, the avulsion is produced, but in case of the fast loading, if we are loading the bone ligament bone complex fastly, then there is a possibility that it may cause injury. For example, in case of the ACL, of the torque is produced in the knee, and it happens just suddenly, like in a very few seconds it happens. And this caused the injury because the because in that case of the ACL, fast loading happens, and this leads towards the injury. Now we will discuss about the creep and the low relaxation curve here. So there we have this low relaxation curve. There's what happens when you apply a set change in length to the tendon and measure the force over time here. As you hold the length constant, here we discuss that in the load relaxation, we are keeping the length constant. So if you do that, you will notice that load drops off here. You see that the load is dropping off. There's a change in force over time, and this is called the load relaxation. And when you have the displacement constant, and you observe a drop in the force as a result here. So the second test is a creep phenomenon. In the case of the creep phenomena, we apply a set force and monitor the displacement required to maintain the force. So this phenomena is called the creep. Here you have a change in length, a change in deformation as you hold the load constant. Here you see the whole load is like constant, and you're keeping a constant force, and you're observing that in order to keep the constant force, you have to stretch the tissue more and more and more, and this is called the creep. Here you see we have the change in the length while keeping the load constant. So now if you look at the examples of this, then we have this scoliosis present. If someone has bad scoliosis, a curved spine, here you can see a curved spine, then one of the treatments that they will do before they go to the level of inserting a rod in the spine here, like this is a normal spine and here is the curved spine. And so in order to straighten this out, sometimes they like insert a rod in the spine, but before doing that, they do the treatment using this creep response. And they go to, before going to the level of inserting a rod in the spine, and they use the bracing where the subject wears. There's a bracing for a significant fraction of the day, and maybe it's like 20 hours a day. The idea is that you're applying pressure to the body in the places there. Here we have like three places here. You are applying pressure in here. This is an example of the creep response because you're keeping and the load because you're applying the pressure on it and keeping the load constant. Another example is that the club foot, which is the subjecting the constant loads by means of a plaster case. In this case, we are keeping the load constant. It means that we have the creep response in this case. So both of them are the examples of the creep response. So next, if we move towards the ligament failure and the tendon injury mechanism, and then we see that the injury mechanism in both tendons and ligaments is similar. They fall into two general categories, or maybe like three general categories. We have this high level of stress as those which cases where an external violence occurs, then we have this high rates of strain. And such cases in which an overuse injury or repetitive microtrauma surpass the repairing process. And then we have the combination of both levels of stress, like high level of stress and the high rates of the strain. And in this case, ligament injury in contact collision, ligament injury occurs, for example, in the contact collision sports. So when a ligament is subjected to loading, microfailure takes place before yield point when loading exceeds the physiological range. So what is the physiological range? Let me explain it here. Here, we have a physiological range here when the linear region of when the point where the linear region end from the toe to the end of the linear region, we have the physiological range here. So this region from here to here, this is the physiological range. So and before load, microfilia takes place before yield point, when load exceeds the physiological, as I just showed you guys, and that the physiological range ends at the end of the linear displacement. After this yield point, gross failure results, we have already seen in the load elongation curve that when the that the failure occurs after this yield point, and the joints begin to displace abnormally. So because of this joint displacement, once one joint is displaced, there are chances that it might affect the surrounding structures as well, which includes the joint capsule and the other ligaments, or also the blood vessel, which can be very dangerous because the joint is displaced now and it is not in its original position. So there is possibility that it might damage the surrounding tissues and cells. For example, I have this ACL injury, anterior cruciate ligament displacement of the tibiofemoral joint. So we'll discuss about the anterior drawer test to Kadevani up to the point of the ACL. Here we have the anterior drawer test with, in which we load the ACL anterior cruciate ligament to the failure. So how this happens is that in order to perform the anterior drawer test, you bring your patient hip to the 45 degrees. Here you see we have this 45 degrees angle here at the hip region, and the knee to the flexion angle should be like 90 degrees. Like here, this we have a 90 degrees angle here. Here we have 45 degrees of the hip, and the flexion angle we have 90 degrees. So we palpate the joint with your thumb here. You palpate the joint with your thumb and try to move the tibia anteriorly in an explosive manner. Like suddenly you pull it, the test is positive if the tibia translates anteriorly more than 6 millimeters, like we have here, more than 5 millimeters or more than 6 millimeters. If it translates anteriorly more than 5 millimeters or 6 millimeters, then the test is positive, like your ligament is good to go. So at maximum load, the joint had displaced several millimeters, and the ligament elongation increases the ligament elongation beyond its elastic region. So the ligament undergo extensive macrophilia and microphilia with a resultant structural damage. If we during this test, if we elongate the ligament across the yield point, like a macrophilia, microphilia occur, then we have this damage that will occur. If we look at the graph of this anterior drawer test, then we have this into four regions, divided into four regions. We have this first region, second, third, and fourth region. So first region is performed clinically, and load is placed on the ACL during the test. Then we have this load placed during the physiological conditions, here you can see here, and then load imposed on the ligament, and it when it reaches a deformation, here we have this region, third region. You can see on the graph here too that we have this microphilia, as we discussed here, that we can have the microphilia and the macrophilia. So in the fourth region, we have the complete rupture here. As you can see also here, we have complete failure. So these are the four regions, 1, 2, 3, and 4 regions of the anterior drawer test. And the load elongation, force elongation graph in this case is like similar to the load elongation graph we have seen earlier. So this was the anterior drawer test. Now we see the classification of the ligament injury. The ligament injury is classified into like three categories: grade 1, grade 2, and grade 3. So we have this normal ligament, and then in the grade 1 injury, we have mild pain, no joint instability, micro tear, a few collagen fiber. Here you see that these little dots, these are the micro tear of the few collagen fibers. little, like there's like a small stretching and small tears in the collagen fibers, but when it reaches to the grade 2 sprain, we have a larger and more tear happens. Like they are not little tears, they are like bigger tears. The tendon collagen fibers start to tear up, and they cause severe pain and joint instability. And so we have this again, grade 3 sprain here in the ligament injury, which caused the severe pain, but less after the injury. We have complete tear here after the complete rupture. You will not feel like a lot of pain. And the there you will see a complete rupture here, but there is a possibility that few of them might still stay intact, and this will cause like severe pain. In some cases, you will see that ligament injury happens when you have this inversion of the foot, like while walking. This can lead to the ligament injury, this sudden load that is applied on the ligament can lead to the ligament injury. Here we will discuss the additional factors that cause the tendon injuries. There are two factors that cause additional tendon injury, which is the amount of force produced and the cross-sectional area of the tendon. These are the two factors that affect the tendon injury. So if we discuss the amount of force of the contraction, tendon is subject to increasing stress and its muscles as its muscles contract. So when the muscle is maximally contracted, the tensile stress on the tendon reaches the high level. So the type of muscular contractions influence loads generated, and the eccentric contractions produce the greater tensile loads, whereas the concentric contractions produce the least. As we have already, I have already explained what are the concentric and the eccentric stresses. Concentric, eccentric is when the we have the muscle fibers are getting elongated, and we have the concentric contractions where the muscle fibers are getting relaxed. So we have like least like stress in case of the concentric. So if we discuss about the cross-sectional area of the tendon, then we have this the strength of a muscle depends on its physiological area. So the larger the cross-sectional area of the muscle, the higher the magnitude of the force produced by the contraction. And thus the greater tensile loads transmitted through the tendon. Similarly, we have the larger the cross-sectional area of the tendon, the greater the load it can bear. So why muscle ruptures are more common? So here is a reason for that. The tensile strength of the tendon may be more twice than that of the force of muscle contractions. So healthy tendons are like more stronger than the muscles. So large muscles usually have large tendons. Here we are going to see some examples of and the larger and smaller tendons. So we have the large muscles here. We have tendons with large cross-sectional areas. So the examples of this is the examples are the quadriceps muscle. Here we have a quadricep muscle with the patellar tendon, and we have this triceps foramen muscle with the Achilles tendon. Here we have the triceps foramen muscle, and this here, this is the Achilles tendon here. So we can see that we have tendons with a large cross-sectional area in both of these cases, but we also have muscles with us have muscles with tendons having the large cross-sectional area, although the muscles are small, such as the plantarius muscle, in which the muscle is tiny, but the cross-sectional area of the tendon is large. We have this small muscle here, and we have this large tendon here. So the two most common pathological issues seen in tendons described is in the literature usually is tendinitis and tendinosis. Let's discuss what they are. So tendinitis is a painful tendon dysfunction, and on the other hand, tendinosis is the inflammation of the tendon itself. Here you see we have this Achilles tendon here, and we have this tendinitis here. We have the inflammation produced here, and there is a possibility that when the more load or stress will be applied, it may lead to the tear of the tendon. So in case of the tendinopathy, and this is a like primary pathology in collagen degeneration. Tendinopathy is actually the appropriate term to use because it encompasses all conditions related to the tendon pathology. A common mechanism of injury in tendinopathy is related to the high rates of strain. Like higher strain causes the tendinopathy and all the other injuries related to the. So here we have a case study, which is the ACL injury, anterior cruciate ligament injury. So we have a case study here in which we have a soccer player, and the ACL injury in soccer is a result of the abnormal torque in the rotation of the knee, as you can see here. Like just let it play. Here you see the abnormal torque in the knee. We have it here, and this leads to the rupture of the ligament here. The player actually locked the foot on the ground and pivoted his lower limb, which produced high rotational torque in the knee. So we have here a high rotational torque in the knee. So a knee with the ACL injury will undergo abnormal intra-articular joint motion as a result of lack of such an important stabilizer. So we have this another question here, that why ACL injury can lead to the early osteoarthritis. So the answer we have here, like this is the answer for this, that the change in the pathway of the joint center of rotation could be observed. And as a, because when we have a change in the pathway of one joint, it can produce stress on the other joints because it is not completely handling all of the stress on itself because it is displaced. So as a result of this, the stress is distributed to the other joints, and which can with abnormally high stress on the other joint surface and structures such as cartilage. Like it is putting stress on its on cartilage and other joints. So this can lead to the degenerative joint diseases. Here we have the graph for this ACL injury. If we look at this, we have again this toe region, we have this again linear region, and we have this microphilia and the complete failure region. At the end of the linear region, we have this microphilia. It means that the failure has occurred. But in the first region of the curve show a normal physiological loading response. However, the mechanism of injury increased strain deformation leading to internal stress leading to the rupture, because in this case, the rate of deformation was high because there was like high rotational torque in this case, and that led to the complete failure abruptly and suddenly. The zones 2 and 3 represent the elastic and plastic regions. Here we have already seen and discussed previously too. The load deformation continues and complete failure is reached here. The injury region represents microfailure and complete failure within the ligament. So here we have this another case study, which is the Quervain tenosynovitis. In this this condition involves the restriction or the lack of the thumb motion. Now, what's important to remember is that these the two tendons that are involved in this tenosynovitis is that abductor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis, like APL and EPB. We have this APL here and EPB, and this is a region of the pain that caused this injury or the inflammation in this case. So we have this these two tendons here, we have this and we have this. These are involved in the inflammation here. So what we need to remember is that these tendons are covered by a sheath, and that sheath or synovium essentially makes a oily fluid that helps the tendons to move freely. So what happens is that a sheath becomes inflamed So you have the inflammation of the sheath here. Here you feel the inflammation here, and because this is the region of the tendon where you will like feel in the inflammation. Yes. So as the sheath is surrounding the tendons, that will cause pain and restriction of the motion. In this case, it will cause a restriction of the motion of the thumb because both the tendons are involved in the motion of the thumb here. And if you're feeling the pain in this region, it means that you have the inflammation in the tendon sheath. So how this happens, if you see, look at the graph of this tenosynovitis, then we see that what actually causes this is the repetition of loading and unloading. As we as I have already explained previously in the hysteresis, and that we have elongation and we have loading and unloading of the tendon or ligament, which causes the hysteresis. So in this case, we have repetitive, like again and again, repetition of the elongation and of the loading and unloading, and that will cause the increased number of cycles here, like 1, 2, and 3, again and again, loading and loading will perform the cause the deformation. So we have the stress strain curve here, and the cyclic loading progresses and indicate deformation and possible molecular displacement here. So as the number of cycles increases, the percentage of deformation increases because we are like loading and unloading again and again, and this process is like continuous and repeating again and again. So this will lead to the tenosynovitis. Okay. So here we have, as I have already just told you, that it is a repetitive nature of the injury. The injury ends up overpassing the healing process. Sometimes it happens and that you feel the inflammation, but you do not take notice of the inflammation. And you like keep working, you keep using your thumb, and this will lead to the to the stage where the healing process becomes difficult. So this may be frequently observed in patients with the Quervain syndrome, but more common with the individual of rotatory cuff tendinopathy. These are the different pathologies that happens. And so the main risk factor in this case is the repetition of the activity. Again, this is the repetition of the activity that happens again and again, the loading and unloading, the stress gets applied, and then it goes to its normal position again, and then the stress is applied again. So we have this healing of tendon and ligaments here. We have three phases for the healing of the tendons and ligaments. Okay, so healing process of tendons and ligaments are same as that of the other tissues. So we have like three regions, and if you include a fourth region, we have this bleeding occur from where this healing process starts, because whenever the bleeding will occur, a blood clot will form, and then the healing process will start. So if we talk about these regions of the three phases of the healing, we have inflammation region, and this is considered the initial response to the tissue injury. Okay, and so the time frame for this inflammation region, inflammation phase is the 2 weeks. So in this case, serous fluid begins to accumulate in the interstitial space here, causing the edema. So leukocytes and macrophages here, we have macrophages, they start to accumulate here and remove the cellular debris from here, because we have this injury here, we have a blood clot here, so it is necessary to remove the debris from this region so it may heal properly. Then we have this proliferative region here, which is the time frame for this is 2 days to 6 weeks, and repair process is initiated in the tissue. This is the phase where the healing process is actually initiated. Then fibroblasts synthesize the collagen, because it is actually the collagen that forms the fibers. So the extracellular matrix, so capillary buds begin to develop here. in this region and revascularize the tissue. So the collagen is formed in this phase, but it is disorganized, not organized, it is disorganized. Collagen is formed, but disorganized. Then we have this last phase, which is a remodeling phase. The time frame for this is 6 weeks almost. Collagen that was formed in this phase but was disorganized will now organize in this remodeling phase of the healing. And this process increases the strength of the healing tissues. So we have this because the tendons and ligaments are like have limited vascularity. This process lead to the scars. We have, as you can see here, we have scars in here because of the limited vascularity, because tendons and ligaments like they are inferior to the normal tissues biomechanically. So they cause the scar tissue that is characterized by the persistent flaws. So abnormally reduced diameter of the collagen fibrils, because the tendon or ligament may recover, but they might not be exactly as they used to be before the injury. So we have variation in the ability of tendons and ligaments to heal. We have some examples here. A good example is a medial collateral ligament of the knee. We have this, which can anterior medial. Yes, we have this medial collateral ligament here. We have this. We just saw this. So it healed fully after the total rupture without the need of the intervention. So like we have different cases. In some cases, where the injury heals completely, but in other cases, it does not heal completely. And there are also cases where we have to perform grafting. So the other ligaments such as ACL require grafting. So this is the grafting technique, and that we are taking the piece of tendon or ligament from some other region and place it at the point of rupture or the injury. So in the case of the tendons, incomplete tears can heal, particularly in case of Achilles. So we have this Achilles tendon, and this tendon can heal completely in case of the incomplete tears. But if we have a complete tear, we will be needing the grafting process. And I will just tell you about what grafting is exactly. So it is nearly impossible for the long flexor tendons of the fingers to heal without surgical reattachment. Again, we have two different conditions. There are conditions in which the tendon or ligament is recovered completely. And there are conditions in which we need surgery or grafting process in order to heal the tendon or the ligament. For example, in case of the flexor tendons in the finger hands, here we have in the fingers. So what exactly is grafting? This is allograft tissue, reconstruction of the torn ligament or the tendon. This is what you call grafting. So we have two types of grafting here. We have allografts and we have the autografts. So what we do in this is that take the piece of the ligament from a region and graft it at the place of the injury. So if we graft from a different individual, then that will be called an allograft. But if we derive the graft from the same individual, then that will be called the autograft. So allograft tissue are the bone patellar tendon, bone and Achilles tendon are used for the allograft tissue. But for the autograft tissue, central tissue of the patellar tendon is commonly used. So we need to keep this in mind, that what kind of tissues are used in both allograft and the autograft conditions. So here we have an allograft and the autograft examples here. So there you see, we have this, autografting is happening in here. We have this like torn tendon and we are going to like replace it. But in here we have allograft. This is the ACL graft here, and we had just placed the, took the graft from another place and placed it here. So allografts and autografts are useful in ligament construction reconstruction, but medial properties do not return completely to normal levels. So as I have just told you, that this is possible. There is a possibility the tendon ligament may not heal properly the way it was before the injury. So we have this until here. We will continue. And the factors affecting the tendon and ligament healing and everything in the next.